you know, to one or two are called bedrooms, some hall, some family room, some bathroom, some, so the names are given. And after some 10 years, you have a different idea. You pull down the whole thing. Does anything happen to space? What was bedroom? What was bathroom? All of them were space, given some name. So when those structures were in place, the walls were in place, as though they became various parts. Space never got divided, right? So Shankara says, though it is an anshah, it is in a relative sense, in a deeper sense, Brahma never gets divided. And this has, if you reflect on it, if you discuss with the Advaita teachers, you will find that it is not just playing with language or playing with analogies. It can compete with the finest thought currents in physics or other sciences. It can compete with that. Advaita's position is very, very subtle and superior in philosophical terms. But then there is ruchi, prashna of ruchi, question of ruchi. However beautiful it may be. In fact, one young man, I took him in my team in one Upanishad project. He happened to be from this Iyengar, Vishnu, Visishtadvaita background. Not only he was born into this Visishtadvaita, Sri Vaishnava family, like one of your priests here is Sri Vaishnava by background. You know, this person in Bangalore somehow was quite, you know, not fanatical, but quite strong about Ramanuja's view. One day, as we were discussing our Upanishad project on phone, I am in Himachal, he is in Bangalore. He, in between, he gave me a piece of advice. He said, Swamiji, I am working for you and you are teaching mainly Advaita and I will give you all my support, but let me tell you one thing. I said, what is that? This Shankaracharya, your inspiration, the problem is he lived only 32 years. I said, what is it? Why is it a problem? You and I actually admire him for that. In 32 years, Shankara wrote so many commentaries. We are happy. But this young man, you know, first time I heard that comment, he said, if he had lived some more years, he would have found out that Advaita is not true. He would have come out with version 2. Or version, like software you say, no? Version
2.
3.4. And that would have been Ramanuja's Visishtadvaita. I said, wow, very nice. I don't believe so. Shankara did not have to live for some more years. These are all divine. We believe Shankara was an incarnation of Shiva himself. That's our belief. So, but anyhow, I like your line of thinking. According to him, Shankara not only lived just 32 years, but was in a little hurry to quell that karmakanda, you know, the overemphasis on just rituals. You know, people's inability. Vedic scholars were not able to see beyond rituals. So, to counter them, he proposed Advaita, according to that young man in Bangalore, and then he walked away. If he had stayed on a little bit, things would have got better. Interesting. But again, I respect all, you know, ruchi. You know, in Shiva Mahimna Stotra, there is an expression. Ruchi naam vaichitryat, raju kutila nana patajusham, nrinam eko gamyas, tvamasi payasa marana vaiva. In a little complex Sanskrit. What it means is, O Shiva, it's a Shiva Stuti, Shiva Mahimna Stotra. O Shiva, you are the one truth. However, ruchi naam vaichitryat, because people in the world have different tastes. Some like coffee, some like tea, some like meat, some like vegetarian food. Ruchis are different taste. Therefore, some go for Vishnu, some go for Shiva, some go for Indra, some go for Ganesha. But as far as I am concerned, the poet there, Pushpadanta, his name, one Gandharva wrote it. As far as I am concerned, you are that one ocean where all the rivers finally go and meet. Nrinam ekaha gamyaha tvamasi payasam nadinam Arunava iva, Samudraha iva. They were nice punchline. So, we must respect each other's ruchi. And we must urge, these days especially in this global village as we call it, you and I should lay emphasis on being good human beings, respect each other's faiths, and have more dialogue, and just remove any fanaticism or labeling or forcible conversions or converting by temptation, tempting them to piece of land or this or that. Those are all very irreligious practices. Thank you again. Mamai Vamsha is literally in favor of Ramanuja, but upon interpretation, Madhva and Shankara says this is the meaning. Yeah. Oh, thank you. Correct. For a moment. Observe, inspect, and question thyself. Correct. In this journey towards enlightenment, we may use one tool like you mentioned, pranayam, in brackets, controlled breathing. This practice intended to achieve calmer state of mind. Yeah. This can give you chance to observe, inspect, and question thyself rationally. Person's rationality depends on intelligence, knowledge acquired in the past? Question mark. It seems like circular referencing in programming languages. Oh. Circular referencing in programming languages. It cannot exit the loop unless you debug your mind. Can you please comment on this? Yeah. So, the good news that I would share with you is many a time it does look like a loop. I think what the questioner puts his name as Curious George. Oh, you are Curious George. Okay, very nicely expressed. Thank you. So Curious George has this to ask. There is the expression catch 22. You know, unless you have A, you can't get B. And unless you have B, you can't get A. So to get A, B is a prerequisite. But to have B, A is a prerequisite. In our village, there was a proverb about some uncontrollable, mischievous, little madcap young boy. You know, in my mother tongue, there was a saying, unless you get him married, he won't get all right. But unless he gets all right, nobody will give him a girl. So that's a catch 22. Anyway, without going for more parallels or analogies, is it true that unless we have certain intelligence and knowledge, we won't be able to see clearly? Unless we see clearly, our intelligence has no chance of opening up. The bad news is, yes, we are all caught in this catch 22. How do we exit this loop? But the good news is, as there is a certain reduction in distractions, certain amount of reduction in false beliefs, certain reduction in the intensity of negative emotions. We have lust, we have anger, we have jealousy, let us say, but to a certain extent they have subsided. Either in frequency, less often they hit us. Somebody in Chennai, a wonderful Vedanta teacher, Swami Paramarthananda, he coined a phrase, F-I-R, F-I-R. How do we know our spiritual progress? His answer is by applying F-I-R. What is F-I-R? F is for frequency. Frequency of negative emotions rising in me has reduced. Earlier I used to get angry 7 times a day. Now I get angry once in 7 days. Which is better? Once in 7 days, far better than 7 times a day. Frequency has reduced. Secondly, intensity. Earlier when I go to get angry, somebody says, let us say, it was so intense, others also used to feel such harshness coming from me, and I myself used to suffer, somebody says. But today, I do get angry, but it's not so intense. Thirdly, R stands for, F-I-R, R stands for restoration time. Restoration time means, in this example, a man gets angry or a lady, you know. Earlier it would take 3 days for her to get back to normal. But today, you know, she gets angry, but within 3 hours or 3 minutes, she is back to, you know. If she even comes to the person whom she might have yelled at and says, sorry, sorry. So, not easy. So, reduction in F, frequency, reduction in I, intensity of negative emotions, and reduction in restoration time, F-I-R, can facilitate, then a certain quantum leap can take place. From here, you just are there. When you are struggling, it seemed hopeless. I'll never get better. But don't give up the struggle. With study, make it more mature struggle, and you'll find one day, suddenly as though, you know, that anger, that lust, or that jealousy, that low self-esteem, where did it go? Where did it vanish? It is said. Saints and mystics have always promised us. Therefore, what you said is so true, but when there is a reduction of all these negative forces, a certain miracle happens. I call it quantum leap. From here, without going to an intermediate level, in physics you have that expression, a particle goes from one energy level to another energy level without touching at all intermediate energy. From Fort Worth, you find yourself in Austin, and not by road, not by air, not by sea, not by any other path you have touched any town or point in between. That's just miracle. But that is, in atomic physics, that is the thing, quantum leap, energy packets. Thank you again. So, Anu.
Swami, Bhagavad Gita chapter 18, Moksha, Sannyas, Yoga,
yeah.
So Mukti by doing the Nishkam Karma Sutta.
Mm-hmm.
So the third verse, Ishvara Pitamne Chakuram, there's a similarity.
See, 18th chapter, Moksha, Sannyas, Yoga, talks about many topics.
Yeah.
But definitely some shlokas there are exactly this.
Karma.
Therefore, Karma Yoga is expressed pretty much in all the chapters. So, no wonder Gandhi, Tilak and others highlighted it. But we would say, Shankaracharya would say that along with Karma Yoga, in every chapter there is Jnana also. Even in third chapter, which is titled Karma Yoga, suddenly towards the end Sri Krishna says, Prakriti is doing everything, but an ignorant person thinks he is doing. He really is not doing. He is only the pure awareness. This is Jnana. That Karmanye Vadhikaraste takes suddenly a back seat. You know. Just a while ago he had said, you must do work anasakta, without selfish attachment. Asango hi acharan karma paramapnoti purushaha tasmad asaktaha satatam karyam karma samachara. Asakta means unattached. Unattached doesn't mean without any interest. We must have enthusiasm, we must have interest. Somebody translated asakta. Asanga means here onward do all your duty without much interest. Drag on, pull on. That would be a terrible distortion of the Gita's spirit. One works with all enthusiasm, but inwardly there is no, one doesn't keep an eye on what do I get here, the I, me and my. That takes a back seat. We work for a cause, we work for something noble, in which definitely we are also going to get the benefit. It's not that one works and doesn't want any benefit. One will get the benefit, but the focus is on the total good, the collective good. Yeah.
So in the 25th verse, right, you mentioned that in order to, so we have our mental condition, And I think to understand our true nature, do we have to continuously be aware and reject the, and recognize or discriminate, saying that anything that's coming from our mental conditioning should be negated, and you just say, this is not true, this is not true, this is not true. Is that how we should approach it?
We do say sometimes we must look at mental conditionings, our bias, our prejudice, so many words we use, and we must negate them. But really, to be more precise, we must understand, and rest of it happens. What I mean by rest of it happens is, we understand a certain position that we have towards a situation. When there is right understanding, which requires a lot of careful observation, not hurriedly taking sides, then the truth will come out. Quite possibly, a position we have taken with regard to some matter could be right. It is not biased. It is based on facts. Then it will remain. It won't get negated. And quite possibly, when we carefully examine a certain position that we have taken and find